Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you very much, Professors Remy, Professor Sadiq, and the rest of the members of the board and the members of the World Heart Failure Society. First, for your kind nomination and your prize. And secondly, for like to thank you for the effort you have given to this society in bringing people together in this fourth international meeting. My talk will be on the clinical and echocardiographic features of endomyocardial fibrosis. I'm just taking you away from the area of ischemic heart disease into one of a rather rare form of heart disease. It's rather interesting. This is a crane, birth seen in my country, and endomyocardial, let us refer to it as EMF, is very much underdiagnosed condition and missed in fact. Quite often is missed in the cases of rheumatic valvular disease and atrial cardiomyopathies. It's one of the most common restrictive cardiomyopathies, and it's first been described by Loeffler in 1936 in a patient with an associated eosinophilia. And later works has been done by Bedford and Gonestam, 1946. But the majority of the work on endomyocardial fibrosis was carried out by Dr. Davis in Uganda, who first noted in some of the Rwandan patients in the borders with Uganda. He noticed that they have this abnormal heart failure, and eventually after post-mortem, they could define this condition or this entity, and the credit goes to him for laying the first clinical features and the pathological diagnosis to the extent that he earned the name of the disease being named after him. Geographically, it is seen in Central and West Africa, but cases have been reported from other parts of the world, especially from the wet tropical areas, including South America, like in Bahia, some reports are coming from Kerala in India, Egypt, and other countries. The prevalence is being reported by the THESIS heart failure study, which is the sub-Saharan heart failure study. Prevalence was given as 1.3% of the total cases of heart failure. But however, higher figures is being quoted from Uganda, as you can see, 25%, and recent work in Mozambique has been done on a population basis and showed 19% of people with heart disease have an endomyocardial fibrosis. Reports also came on the right in EMF from Egypt, Bahia, Brazil. Also cases are coming from India and Nigeria. However, the Nigerian reports are showing a decline in the prevalence of this disease. The etiology of the disease just behaves like a vector-transmitted disease, and the cardiac pathology of the EMF and hypereosinophilic syndrome are identical. Eosinophilia subsides to leave behind endomyocardial fibrosis, as been reported. But this, I seem, is related to several diseases like microfilaria, bilharzia, malaria, malnutrition. But however, the etiology remains obscure. But the advances have been made quite a lot in the diagnosis with echocardiography and recently with CT and cardiac MRI. And advances were also seen in the way of treatment and both medical and surgical treatment. In Sudan, very few cases are seen, and very occasionally that you see a patient with EMF. And the most cases are coming from the western, from the southern and southern and part of Kordofan in Sudan, and therefore, and they all come with an advanced heart failure. This is the area circulated for you to see it, and this is some of the people who live in that area in Sudan, nomads and villagers who are farmers in that part of the world. The first report of EMF in Sudan came by Dr. Copine, who is a British physician practicing in Sudan in 1952 who noticed that few cases of heart failure pass and without diagnosis. Eventually, described 25 cases, and following postmortem, we also established that these cases were due to endomyocardial fibrosis. And later, work came from Al-Hassan, Professor Al-Hassan, doing postmortem in 13 cases of cardiomyopathy, 6 were found to have the same pathological features of endomyocardial fibrosis. However, the diagnosis, this clinical diagnosis is not easy and cannot be confirmed easily because the non-specific diagnostic findings, most patients present with advanced heart failure and ascites, and the X-ray offers only large heart, and the blood test like eosinophilia is very unhelpful and it's very rare to see. The echo came into existence recently, and in fact it's one of the best tools for diagnosis, and reports are showing that from Mozambique by Mokambi that 82.8% agreement shows 82% agreement with the intraoperative findings. They used for the first time portable echo in a population-based study in Mozambique where the prevalence was shown to be 20%. Again, a recent study on Uganda showing endomyocardial fibrosis by echocardiography to be up to 19%, and one of the most common causes of heart failure in that part of the world. Recent diagnostic aids came from CT and an MRI, as I have told you. And now we'll just talk about this study, which is a collection of cases of endomyocardial fibrosis. First, we obtained enough clinical data, and the purpose of the study was just to study the clinical and echocardiographic patterns of this disease. And we collected history, the brief clinical tests like ECG, chest X-ray, CBC, and especially for eosinophilia. But the diagnosis was based mainly on echocardiography. 3,032 cases were collected. Out of these, 17 had the diagnosis of endomyocardial fibrosis. Very low percentage, 0.4%. Common, very non-specific symptoms, dyspnea, in most of them, in heart failure, wasn't 74% of them. Strangely enough, ascites was commonly seen in these people, even those without heart failure. Here is a case of a patient with EMF. You can see the huge ascites with less edema of the ankles. And as I told you, the chest X-ray is not diagnostic, it's huge heart. And this is due to the size of the atria and pericardial effusion, which is commonly seen in this condition. Again, the ECG is not specific, and the hematology doesn't offer much except for if you are fortunate to find absolute eosinophilia, which has been reported in some of the cases. And here we found only in 3 cases. Now we look into the echocardiographic findings. It can either be vivant ventricular of both sides, right and left, or purely left ventricular, which is the commonest type, or right ventricular. Now this is a classical appearance of an echocardiogram from a patient with endomyocardial fibrosis. And you can see striking huge right atrium, apical fibrosis and fibrosis of the left ventricular flow tract, and the obliterated left ventricle. Findings that you don't see in any other conditions. If you're talking about rheumatic heart disease or rheumatic mitral regurgitation, you'll get this ventricle bigger than this. But look at the huge atria and the small ventricle. These are three, together with the apical fibrosis, these are three very diagnostic findings of endomyocardial fibrosis. And here is a short axis view of that same patient. You can see clear endocardium, clear myocardium, and pericardial effusion, which is what's called layering. So you see the three layers together. If you look at the posterior mitral valve leaflet, you see it tethered to the endocardium. So The layering is a feature that you can see in this condition. And the M mode will show it even better. You can see clear endocardium, pericardium, bone bright into the fibrosis. And the mitral regurgitation that's often associated with the atrioventricular valves on both sides. And you can see this is the mitral regurgitation usually. The posterior leaflet is tethered to the endocardium, and the mitral valve behaves like a single leaflet valve, and a lot of blood passes down during the systole. And here is another case, another patient. You can see the apical fibrosis, the ventricular flow tract fibrosis, and the huge left atrium obliterated, very small left ventricle. Now, this is, you can see it more here in the apical view, huge, measuring more than 10 centimeters. And again, a short axis for this same patient. See, again, the layering process, the endocardium, bright endocardium, myocardium, and often you see pericardial effusion in these cases. So now you can record these four as diagnostic features of endomyocardial fibrosis and move ahead to see more signs of endomyocardial fibrosis. And here, this is a modified apical long axis. You can see endocardium here, and this is a posterior mitral valve leaflet completely tethered to the endocardium. The mitral valve, as I said, is just behaving with single leaflet here, and this is the curve of the severe regurgitation that you see. Also, you can notice the retraction of the ring here in this area of fibrosis. Again, this is another feature. You can see the endocardium and the posterior mitral leaflet completely lost inside the endocardium. This appearance has been termed a crest formation, and you can see also here this crest formation is very diagnostic of endomyocardial fibrosis. It can help in the differential diagnosis between this and rheumatic heart disease. Again, you can see this thin anterior mitral valve leaflet moving, and it is, as we said, a single leaflet valve. So we can add this tethering of the posterior mitral valve leaflet to the left ventricular endocardium and the formation of the crest, which is very diagnostic of this condition. Now moving further ahead, we can see the right ventricle. The right ventricle, this is Dr. Sadik, talk a lot about it, this is Professor Sadik. You can see it here again, in this case, fibrosis, the huge atrium, small right ventricle, and pericardial effusion. And this is the right ventricle. Right ventricular endomyocardial fibrosis. Again, this is another case of right ventricular endomyocardial fibrosis. And here, this is a biventricular endomyocardial fibrosis, where both ventricles are affected. Huge atria. This is the typical appearance of the biventricular type. Another feature is the restrictive flow pattern. As we said, it is one of the commonest causes of restrictive cardiomyopathies. And you can see here the short deceleration time, and you see again evidence of mitral regurgitation there. Another feature is this is again another right ventricle endomyocardial fibrosis, and you can see this is the mass, which is in fact is a clot thrombus formation. So it's thrombus formation is commonly seen either in atria or ventricles. So now we can put all these findings together, and these are the echo features of endomyocardial fibrosis, starting from the apical, the endomyocardial layering, the AV valve regurgitation, the obliteration of the cavity, the gross atrial enlargement, tethering, and crest formation, the pericardial effusion, the restrictive flow pattern, and the atrial or ventricular thrombi. Now, there are problems that should be very careful to identify rheumatic heart disease with the feature that we described in this table you've seen now. And also, you have to differentiate it from the apical fibrosis. Difficult sometimes, but in a report here, you can see this is an AMF, and this is apical fibrosis. Difficult to differentiate because one of the features of endomyocardial fibrosis is apical fibrosis. So, but other workers have suggested that that you can see the fibrosis, apical fibrosis in EMF in both systole and diastole, while you see it more in the apical cardiomyopathy only during the process of systole. But I'm sure Professor Hanan is here. You can tell us more about this later on. Now, with that information, echo information on the diagnosis of endomyocardial fibrosis, put together, we can build a score, which I'm suggesting this type of score. Commonest findings, clinical findings, 100% of the cases, we give them score 4. This is less common, we gave it 3, and the less common ones are coming down to 1. So with a score of 15%, as you see, this is the main features. If you have a score of 15, then you can safely diagnose endomyocardial fibrosis. Now, to conclude, EMF is a disease of unknown etiology, still commonly seen in tropical and subtropical areas. And key points in diagnosis, I said, the huge left atrium, perforated ventricle, the layering, and the AV valve dysfunction. I suggested this point scoring for you to try, and you need to have a high index of suspicion when you see these cases of rheumatic heart disease, whether these are in fact an EMF or rheumatic heart disease. However, we end up by telling you that this disease is rare, it's very rare, as rare as the grain pear, which exists in the same area of EMF in Sudan, and unfortunately, it is now critically endangered, the speech of this beautiful bird. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Khalil. This is a very great presentation. And I guess one question for Professor Michael Nain, if you want to comment on the... give the microphone, please, Sayer. I think we have Professor Hanan here. He is
confess, I haven't seen hundreds of EMFs in my life, but I've seen a few at the Brompton Hospital that they were referred to us with unclear diagnosis whether the patient needs a mitral valve replacement or not because of mitral regurgitation. That was the referral. Now, I go back to your issue about fibrosis. It's fascinating the way how you showed us apical obliteration as well as distribution of fibrosis around the endocardium and the ventricle. Now, the first point I'd like to highlight is the differentiation between EMF and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, particularly the apical one. So probably if we are to put our money on the presence of mitral valve leaflet involvement in EMF rather than HCM, that probably might help us in differentiating between the two conditions. You agree on that, don't you? Number one. Two, the extent of fibrosis around the ventricle. Recently, we ran a study with the Italians, and we took biopsies from the ventricles, transplanted hearts, and we compared them with the intrinsic myocardial properties measured by strain and strain rate. And we came up with an R value of 0.8. This is as high as it could be. So probably if we are in doubt about the presence of myocardial fibrosis, and we have a facility in our echo machine to use myocardial deformation and assess strain, it might help in fact in identifying the patients and following them up over time whether the fibrosis will get worse or not, and that probably might help in, you know, making the right diagnosis. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, just a very short comment.
Well, I just wanted to share our own experience from India. Like this was in Kerala more, so it is becoming less, but we do see in North also. We described endomyocardial biopsy in an European Heart Journal. 70 patients were described. We did biopsies among them. 30 were turned out like restrictive cardiomyopathy, but not in heavy EMF feature. Echo is, of course, the most important, would say. We looked at biopsy mainly from etiopathogenesis, what is the cause? I think we didn't find eosinophilia even in the biopsy specimens. One child, which we serially biopsied over years, and had an endocardial inflammation, but no eosinophils. And then next year, our lipid endocardium became thick. Actually, I had limited time. I would like to show those slides. But we published in European Heart Journal, I think now about 6-7 years back.